Please proceed. Good morning, everyone. I welcome you to this ecumenical service at St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church to commemorate the commencement of Parliament for 2024. In particular, I welcome the Prime Minister, the Honourable Anthony Albanese, and the Leader of the Opposition, the Honourable Peter Dutton, and the Honourable Milton Dick, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, and all the Members of Parliament and Members of the Senate. I also welcome representatives from the Australian Defence Force, representatives from embassies, members of the Australian Public Secretaries, and members of the ACT Legislative Assembly. I also welcome the Radford College Choir, who will be singing later in the service. Finally, I extend a warm welcome to the Reverend Daniel Mossfield, Minister of Crookwell Uniting Church, who is the preacher. At the beginning of the service, I wish to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land we are meeting on today, the Ngunnawal and Ngangarri people. I wish to acknowledge and respect their continuing culture and the contribution they make to the life of this nation and region. When the gospel reading from Luke is read, the congregation will stand. Morning tea will be served at the conclusion of the service in the hall adjacent to the church for those who are able to stay. You are welcome to join us for this time of fellowship. You can access the hall by walking around the church on my left-hand side until you come to the steps, and that will enable you to then enter the hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome very much indeed to this ecumenical service, to the Prime Minister, to the Leader of the Opposition, Speaker of the House, colleagues, members and senators, diplomatic corps, faith leaders. On behalf of the Parliamentary Christian Fellowship, David and I welcome you all here indeed to this cherished tradition of the first opportunity as we come together in the new year to come to church, as we hear the gospel, as we sing hymns, as we hear from the preacher. We are centred, we're reminded of our roles, as our duties, which is, of course, to serve. And so it's terrific to have you all here. And can I thank the Church's Council to David and Reverend David and all of the those that are involved in putting this service together.
Thanks, Matt. I'd also like to welcome our local church leaders, in particular, Your Grace's Archbishop Christopher Prowse, Bishop Mark Short, and Archbishop Bartholomew, and all the faith leaders here today too. And I'd also like to acknowledge that we're coming together here on the land of the Ngunnawal and Ngambri people and pay my respect to elders past and present, and bless the good fortune I've had to represent this land where there's such a connection for thousands of years. I'd like to particularly acknowledge the work of the Reverend David Campbell and the ACT Council of Churches, who've again worked tirelessly so that we may be here this morning and reflect on the year ahead. Those leaves that were raked up yesterday don't do it by themselves. You don't get to your seats by yourselves. The hard-working parishioners of St. Andrews have done a great job again in making us all welcome again this year. Thank you.
Thank you.
We come from scattered lives to this sanctuary to seek our unity in the Spirit, to seek the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, to seek the peace of God the Father. Now that we have gathered in this place, let us worship God together.
Prayer of Confession. God of love, justice, and mercy, it is by love that you created us, and by love you call us to live. But we fail repeatedly, miserably, by what we do and by what we fail to do. We fail to love one another as Christ loved us. We fail even by our own standards. Forgive us, Creator God, God of love, forgive us. By your mercy, allow us to enjoy your forgiveness, won for us by Jesus Christ. Dear God, redeem us, shape us, replace our discord with peacemaking, our boasting with humility, our bitterness with joy. Keep us in your love, your forgiveness, your eternal hope. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Hannah prayed and said, "My heart exalts in the Lord. My strength is exalted by God. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your victory. There is no holy one like the Lord, no one besides you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. The Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry are fat with spoil. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low. He also exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked will perish in darkness, for not by might does one prevail. The Lord, his adversaries will be shattered. The Most High will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the power of his anointed.
It's customary, of course, to not clap in a church, but I do think that rendition of the Lord's Prayer by the Radford College Choir was extraordinarily special, and I assure you that everyone here, from myself down, was clapping in an appropriate way, silently, in this church. That was beautiful. Please. A reading from 2 Corinthians 9, verses 6 to 12. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he has distributed freely, he has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgiving to God.
Gospel reading is from Luke chapter 1, verses 46 to 55. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. For he has looked with favour on the lowly state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done things for me, and holy is his name. Indeed, his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his child Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever.
Will you join me as we pray? You can be seated if you'd like. Living God, we cannot reason our way to you. And there is nothing we can say of you without your gracious gift of revelation. Let us then speak not too proudly this morning, but pour out your spirit on these fallible human words of scripture and sermon, that they might become for us the presence of your living word, Christ our Lord. And all of God's people say, against the backdrop of a global oil shortage, war in the Holy Land, and rising interest rates, the Orthodox theologian Father Alexander Schmemann sat down at his desk in Crestwood, New York, to write in his journal. The year was 1974, and the previous day, Schmemann had just watched President Ford's famous Whip Inflation Now speech. I heard on TV the president's speech about inflation, he recalls. But what nobody says, and obviously does not understand, is that inflation in our times is, above all, a spiritual, psychological condition, a form of consciousness. The whole world, he continues, has become inflation. Inflation of words, of feelings, of relation with life. Inflation is the condition of the frog that starts to puff up and then bursts. When one starts calling the janitor in a store maintenance engineer, it is inflation, his quote. And when the air that we breathe is full of inflation, life is destroyed. If everything is a lie, if everything is endlessly exaggerated, distorted, puffed up, there is no more measure or moderation in anything. Why should a price be increased by 3 cents when it could be increased by a dollar? Again, it was 1974. And it will be accepted. One should start then, he says, not with an economic, but a spiritual struggle. A struggle with inflation as a condition of the heart and of the mind. A struggle with inflation as a condition of the heart and of the mind. In our own age of disruption, the temptation to partake in such inflation is ever present. We contribute to this condition whenever we misrepresent the position of our opponents or mischaracterize our own. Whenever we conflate facts with opinions, drowning objective truth in a sea of subjective ideas. And whenever we overestimate our own ability to fix the world's problems. Nevertheless, our political system demands that you, our elected representatives, do just this. Every 3 years, we choose wise people like you to make hard decisions on our behalf that will solve the collective crises that we all face. We expect you to come up with solutions and policies that will make the world better by degrees, or sometimes overnight. And in so doing, we invite you to become partakers of that very inflation which we then demand you fix on our behalf. It will likely come as a surprise to none of you that when people heard I had been invited to preach here this morning, I was presented with a litany of complaints that I should deliver to you all on their behalf. And I assure you, they were bipartisan. I think many hoped, perhaps knowing that I'd don't always have the best filter. I might give it to you from the pulpit. But the reading today doesn't permit me to do that. You see, I'm the grandchild of a former federal politician. I've seen behind the curtain. I grew up door knocking through the streets of Blacktown and handing out how to votes at Vineyard Public School. And I have seen the cost of the life you live. I have witnessed firsthand the frustration that comes with doing battle daily with the intractability of the status quo. And I am convinced that if we have a problem with inflation in this country, then it must surely begin from the inflated expectations we place upon you as our elected representatives. For despite an innate cynicism built into the bones of many Australians, we nevertheless live in hope that maybe, just maybe, you will be the ones to save us. That maybe, just maybe, you are the Messiah we have been waiting for. You've surely sensed it. Seen it in the hopeful gaze of people that you meet. Perhaps you've even begun to believe it. For such inflation is insidious. It festers in the soul, whispering lies that tell us that it is our job to bring life where there is none, that it is our responsibility to forge a future at the border of brokenness. And when we hear this lie and we believe it to be true, then the reality of falling short is almost too much to bear. There comes a point when no matter how strong one is, the bubble must inevitably burst. A point where after years of fighting, of advocating for yourself or your family or your community, you simply have nothing left. A point where the exhaustion takes over your bones and despair settles in your soul. A point where cynicism wins the day. My prayer is that at the start of a new parliamentary year, none of you are quite there yet. Nevertheless, in our reading today from Samuel, this is exactly the point that Hannah has reached before she sings her song. She has been trying desperately to create new life. Mocked by her opponents, misunderstood by her family and friends, she has exhausted herself in praying for the possibility of a life which she no longer believes is possible. She has reached that point, unfamiliar to preachers and, dare I say, politicians, where she has no words left, where guilt and doubt have stripped her bare with the realization that she cannot change the world by herself. She cannot change the world by herself. And it is only here, in the midst of her deep frustration, that she encounters the God who brings life at the edge of despair. You see, the scriptures sing of God not as an absentee landlord nor a disinterested judge. Instead, they proclaim a God active and involved in the mess of our world. A God who lifts the poor from the dust and the needy from the refuse heaps to which we've consigned them. A God who transforms barrenness into life and seats the persecuted amongst politicians and preachers. A God who will not let us long labor under the misapprehension that the world is somehow ours to save. The American theologian Jim Wallace recalls that during the darkest, deepest days of apartheid, when the government tried to shut down opposition by canceling a political rally, the Archbishop Desmond Tutu declared that he would hold a church service instead. St. George's Cathedral in Cape Town was filled with worshippers. Outside the cathedral, hundreds of police gathered, a show of force intended to intimidate. As Tutu was preaching, they entered the cathedral armed and lined the walls. They took out their notebooks and began to write down every word that he said. But Tutu would not be intimidated. He preached against the evils of apartheid, declaring it could not endure. And at one extraordinary point, he addressed the police directly. "You are powerful. You are very powerful. But you are not gods. And I worship a God who cannot be mocked. So since you've already lost, I invite you to come over and join the winning side." And with that, the congregation erupted in dance and song. The police didn't know what to do. Their attempts at intimidation had failed. Overcome by the Archbishop's confidence that God and goodness would triumph over evil. It was but a matter of time. It's true that of all the people in this country, you have an amazing capacity to make a difference in the lives of ordinary people. It is true that your actions and inactions have tangible and real consequences for the lives of the poor and the persecuted. And it is true that you set the tone for civility and discourse in our country at a time when they have evaporated. Nevertheless, you are not gods. In the face of war, economic crisis, and social division, the good news of the gospel is that the living God is alive and active in the world, bringing hope to barrenness and life at the edge of despair. And you, it turns out, are not nearly as important as you have been led to believe. So hear the good news. You are allowed to get it wrong. You are allowed to ask for forgiveness, even though I appreciate that may be in private, away from media cameras. And you are even allowed to admit that you are human. For the future is secured by the one true God, the living God who raised Israel out of slavery and Jesus from the dead. And this confession alone can save us from the snares of inflation.
Let us all come together now in the prayers for intercession. Church, let us bow our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we pray for the new year of Parliament, which we commemorate today. As you know, our Parliament makes big decisions which impact our everyday lives. We pray for wisdom and guidance for all the members, senators, and senior cabinet ministers to make these decisions on behalf of our nation. We also pray for the staffers, the cleaning staff, and other employees within the Parliament who keep it running day in and day out. Lord, more specifically, we pray for our Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese. Guide him and give him wisdom when he makes decisions and represents our nation. We pray also for Governor General David Hurley. Give him wisdom too, as he represents the King and our nation. We also pray for our local members and our territory senators. We pray for the member of Bean, David Smith, the member for Canberra, Alicia Payne, the member for Fenner, Andrew Lee, And Lord, we pray for our senators too, Katie Gallagher and David Pocock. We pray that you can give them wisdom as they represent our territory and make decisions on behalf of us. So Lord, we put the whole Parliament in your hands and pray for all these things in your name, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we pray for the people and families without homes due to the fires and floods. We pray that you will help them find homes soon. We pray for Indigenous Australians who may be feeling hurt and disappointment after the recent referendum result. But we also pray for the things affecting Australian families, such as financial struggles, domestic violence, the grief of losing loved ones, and any form of abuse. Lastly, we pray for the individual Australian people who are struggling with loneliness. Help them find good friends. We pray for those with mental illnesses and unhealthy habits. We pray for people with addictions, and we pray for those who are being bullied. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord God, source of all wisdom and knowledge, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to live among us and proclaim his timeless message of faith, hope, and love to all. In your goodness, we ask you now to bless all those whom you have called to be peacemakers and bridge builders in world affairs, most especially in places that are experiencing hopelessness, violence, and despair. Strengthen them with your grace. Grant them humility, wisdom, and courage to act responsibly. May they be receptive to the working of your Holy Spirit, so that the peace and healing power of Christ will reign triumphant. May they be signs of hope to the lost, the least, and the lonely. Use them as instruments in your hand, and a voice that calls all people to find a home in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now let us pray the words our Father taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Thank you.